Happy noonday. We're gonna get started here a little bit with our Wednesday noon prayer at Timberline Church Facebook. We are live on Facebook now. Is that correct, Chelsea? Chelsea is nodding. So what time is it, Chelsea?
It's noon!
And the sun is high in the sky. And it's good to be outside. Some of us haven't maybe been outside a lot. I don't know. Or maybe we've been outside more than ever, right? Chelsea, show the folks what's going on behind me. All right? I have my very own camera crew. Chelsea Gomez. Welcome to Timberline Church Noon Prayer on Facebook Live. I am Darren Fred, pastor, one of the two pastors at Timberline Old Town Church and Everyday Joe's Coffee House in the heart of Old Town Fort Collins. And I'm really pleased to be with you and thankful for this opportunity to share this little bit of time with you wherever you are. However you are. And before we move ahead, let's just pause for a moment to just be where we are. Now, I want to tell you briefly what is going on behind me. This is the north wall of Everyday Joe's Coffee House. I'm standing in Mason Lot. Mason Street is to my left. This is a mural project that through generosity of some of our friends we were able to finance, and we have, right now we're painting the canvas. These two that you see here, with their backs to you, Claire and Rachel, are a couple of our local artists and our art director here at Everyday Joe's in Timberline Old Town who are heading up the project. So we're almost, and the rest are volunteers who have given their time today to be with us. What we are doing here is creating the canvas for what will be a painting which imagines or illustrates the imagination of the prophet and poet Isaiah from Isaiah 11. This mural was inspired by this ancient prophecy / poem, which I want to read to you now. I'm going to read this from another artist who is also a theologian, Eugene Peterson, and he paraphrased the scriptures into what is called the Message Bible, and this is his channeling of the poem from Isaiah 11. A green shoot will sprout from Jesse's stump. From his roots, a budding branch. The life-giving Spirit of God will hover over him, the Spirit that brings wisdom and understanding, the Spirit that gives direction and builds strength, the Spirit that instills knowledge and fear of God. Fear of God will be all his joy and delight. He won't judge by appearances. Won't decide on the basis of hearsay. He'll judge the needy by what is right. Render decisions on earth's poor with justice. His words will bring everyone to awed attention. A mere breath from his lips will topple the sturdy work clothes and boots and build righteousness and faithfulness in the most imaginative, and you might say the most outlandish. Foolhardy vision of what could be. Imagine this scene. The wolf will romp with the lamb. The leopard sleep with the kid. Calf and lion will eat from the same trough, and a little child will tend them. Cow and bear will graze the same pasture. Their calves and cubs grow up together, and the lion eats straw like an ox. The nursing child will crawl over rattlesnake dens, the toddler stick her hand down the hole of a serpent. Neither animal nor human will hurt or kill on all my holy mountain. The whole earth will be brimming with knowing God alive, a living knowledge of God, ocean deep, ocean wide. The crescendo. I have three cats. We introduced a third cat recently. Well, as you may know, it's complicated and challenging to bring cats together and have them live in peace, and they're the same species. But 2.5 weeks into it, lo and behold, they're dwelling in relative harmony. And aren't we happy? And doesn't it bring joy to our hearts to see that? How much more of a far-fetched idea that a baby cow, a calf, could lay down by a lion, or a lamb could stand on the back of a wolf, and they would not harm each other, but they would live peacefully. And this is the crazy idea that the poet presents to us of imagine this. And the first listeners of this poem must have almost laughed to hear it. But I believe, and we believe, that when Jesus came, and when Jesus comes, he becomes such a compelling presence that we forget our differences. So whatever has happened here with the creatures in this scene, they have forgotten about that they are adversaries. And they have found something that is so beautiful, so tasty, so lovely, so compelling, that this is what compels them. And they live together enjoying this peaceful place with this something that transcends their differences. And that's what we see in Jesus's life too, don't we? We see Jesus where it's like, what are you doing here? I'm sure people show up. It's like the wolf shows up and says to the lamb, what are you doing here? And the lamb says, I don't know, what are you doing here? And the wolf says, well, I like the coffee here at Everyday Joe's. And the lamb says, me too. And that's how it was with Jesus too, is that it's like we forget. We think differently politically. We think differently about what does it mean re-entry during COVID. We remember what unites us, right? And that's what we're calling people back to at Everyday Joe's Coffee House and in the Timberline Church experience. And now with this piece of art, a visual that says, what if we forgot what it was that separated us? And we find something we agree on that is so much more compelling, so much more life-giving. So as we end our time today, I have three, I guess, directions for us to pray. First of all, for you and me, for us, what is the far-fetched dream that we've given up on, that we need to re-engage with, that I had given up on this person or this idea or this institution, and in some cases we needed to do that, but God is calling us to a far-fetched dream to participate in. Secondly, what notions of the other do we need to let go of in order, if we hold too tightly to what divides us, we won't even see that beautiful thing that compels us beyond that. So what notions of the other do we need to let go of? And third, would we create space in our lives to bring together people who would not otherwise be together, which can be very simple things that we do, you know, like anything that we do, where we bring together something that's creative or beautiful, a meal, music, a work project together, but it brings together those who would otherwise be together. But finally, I want us to close in prayer, and this is the prayer direction I felt led, and that is, I and you, many of us, maybe we let people, the differences, get under our skin. And kind of hearkening back to that first question, what have I given up on? Who have I given up on? And so I want to lead us in a prayer, and I want us to ask each of us to think of a person or a group of persons near to us or far away, someone maybe we know well or someone we don't know well, but someone that we want to release to God and pray for, so that we may have a new vision, as the poet did, and a vision of those who were once far apart coming together in peace. And I'm going to lead us in a prayer. And the first sentence of the prayer is, God, as I hold, and then there's a blank. So let's put the name of that person or perhaps group of people or whatever you like in that blank. So God, as I hold this one, as I hold him now in a moment in my thoughts, I ask that you would hold them eternally in yours, remaining ever at work in their heart and life, even now directing their paths toward your goodness. We pray in the unifying name of Christ, mindful of Christ's presence now, in all of our spaces and all of our beings. Amen. Thanks, everybody. Hope to see you in person soon.